This is actually from food and beverages industry, okay? And this was actually for supply chain, wherein actually, you know, the F&B, the industry actually wanted to probably track the invoice processing, okay? Whatever it was receiving through its suppliers worldwide. So this vendor actually had the 3,800 suppliers worldwide, okay? And these suppliers will spread across 7 geographical regions, okay? North America, Latin America, Europe, Asia Pac, Middle East, Africa, and probably, you know, I think there's one more actually region which I'm seeing, I think Australia actually, okay? So these guys actually, you know, like right now actually, you know, currently actually, it was costing this vendor actually for invoice processing around $4 per invoice, okay? And we recommended actually the implementation of this on a blockchain, okay? And we said actually we'll implement it actually on using Hyperledger fabric, okay? And we did a value proposition and we said actually the cost, the invoice processing cost will come down by 80 to 90%. We implemented this actually for North America region and we were able to bring down the cost for 22 nodes. We implemented it and we were able to bring down the cost down by 90%, which was actually to 40 cents. From $4, it came down to 40 cents. In this case, actually, the participants actually who were there in the network were, first is the vendor, okay? Second is, you have the suppliers, 3,800 suppliers actually who are there worldwide, okay? Then you have actually, like, you know, accounts payable team, actually, who are doing the manual processing of the invoices, okay, in the system. And they're still doing it. The overall implementation would take actually a couple of years, you know, by the time it will be implemented across the globe, actually, not this particular use case. Okay. So this is the, so in this case, the participants are like your supplier, your vendor, which is vendor organization, as well as the accounts payable team. Okay. Here the asset was actually nothing but invoice, okay, which is the asset, which is going to flow onto the network. Okay, so that's your asset. Okay, and the certainly there will be transition states for this asset, where there will be different transition states actually, you know, which will be directly for this asset. Okay, so and we were given access actually to the SAP systems of the vendor. Okay, so vendor was maintaining actually three tables. Actually, one was actually the vendor list. So basically, who were the vendors actually who they were interacting or probably dealing with actually, you know, for the, you know, supply chain where they were, you know, coming across actually the vendors for, I mean, like they were coming across the suppliers and vice versa. Secondly, they were having actually the purchase order. So basically, you know, I mean, like the invoice would be processed certainly against the purchase order. So that purchase order was raised actually by the vendor organization. So what we had actually here, actually, you know, we had a click asset as an invoice, and we had a click access to the vendor organization, actually, you know, SAP systems. So the SAP system was maintaining the vendor list. The purchase order, which was raised, actually was maintained actually as well as the goods received note. So once the purchase order is raised, the goods might be fulfilled by the supplier. Could be in part or could be in full. If it's part, you need to probably ensure that probably the entries are maintained actually in a goods received mode against that purchase order, and till the time actually the purchase order is fulfilled, okay, complete, is fulfilled in complete sense. So till the time goods received mode, actually you'll have actually different versions against the purchase order. And the invoice would be processed actually once the purchase order, the quantities and the goods are met by the supplier against which actually the purchase order was raised. Okay. So so we had actually, you know, these entities to play with, okay, and we had access to the SAP system, okay, with which actually we were interacting. Okay, this was actually from the vendor organization. Okay, and so what we did actually, you know, we had here actually two channels. Okay, one was actually the channel actually where we had actually all these suppliers who will be part of the public chain, okay, along with actually the, you know, suppliers, you'll have the vendor organization, you'll have the accounts payable team, okay. There's another chain actually wherein actually we'll have only the private chain, where we'll have actually the our chain or channel actually I'll call it, where we'll have actually the vendor organization as well as the accounts payable team. So what was happening actually, you know, the messaging service which was deployed actually on this case, so it was simple budget and fault tolerance. Okay. Reason being actually the we had actually all even number of nodes actually in the configuration what we had. Okay. So vendor organization has its own multiple nodes. Plus actually accounts payable team had its own set of nodes, okay, based on the geography actually with which they were interacting. They were involved actually in terms of the invoice processing. I mean purchase order ensuring the purchase order validation to invoice processing. Okay. So in the private channel actually the purchase order was raised by the vendor organization. It will be validated wherein actually certain mandatory fields has to be fulfilled. You need to ensure that purchase order has the required requisite approvals before that purchase order is floated actually onto the public chain. Okay. Once the purchase order is floated actually onto the public chain, it's basically certainly is signed cryptographically with the public key of the supplier, and certainly details is digitally signed by the vendor organization. Okay, PO which was raised. What was happening is we were actually looking at actually once the PO is raised. Okay, what was happening is we had actually ensured the invoice is also carrying actually certain number of fields, mandatory fields actually as part of every invoice raised by the suppliers. So once the invoice comes actually, so until if their invoice was not carrying those mandatory fields, we were not bringing that invoice actually even into the blockchain. Okay, so the story begins actually once, let's say invoice has been validated and is submitted into the blockchain. So invoice submission is done. You don't want actually suppliers to have a view of probably the pricing or the public goods actually what they today actually deal with. Okay, because actually if the suppliers itself would be part of the endorsers, in that case actually a lot of confidential data would be shared among other suppliers actually onto the network, which other suppliers will not be very keen to really be visible or should be shared actually. So suppliers will not be endorsers in this case. Okay, so it was the vendor organization, the accounts payable team who were these endorsers. And the committers were actually all the suppliers as well as actually the endorsers, were the committers. So it was the endorsers plus the suppliers put together were the committers. Okay. So what was happening is once the invoice comes submitted actually onto the network. Okay. We check actually the vendor selection, whether it's an existing vendor or not. Okay. And PO to invoice actually can be remitted. Okay. We look for a duplicate check actually whether this invoice is not duplicate of already being submitted invoice. Okay, if there's one actually it will be rejected. Then actually we check with respect to the budget what was approved actually for the PO which was raised. Okay, if the budget for which it was raised, if there's a deviation by plus minus 5%, we used to take it actually without any exception approvals. Otherwise we would have rejected or probably deleted that invoice. Okay, which has come for or which has been submitted actually by the supplier. We did the matching selection, actually line selection by item, what was there in the PO versus the invoice. Okay, with the price check against all the goods actually what was there actually in the item wise item in PO versus invoice. Additional lines actually if there were one, I mean if there were any, okay, we did actually there could be multiple entries for the same line select or for the same items. Okay, at different pricing, that could also be possible. Okay, because he would have procured a certain goods at a certain price, supplier at the time, and that's probably same goods at a different price from different geographies or different locations or probably within his own warehouse. Okay, so we did those validations, yeah, and then we demanded the matching of the quantities. Okay, so what was the PO was raised for against what was invoices carried. Okay. And the tax actually, what was the tax actually computations which was there actually for the region. Okay, we have DST, other regions may have actually their own set of taxes. Okay, and the payments actually, then finally the payout of the invoice is done once all this has been done. So these were all smart contracts which were raised, which were written actually. So this is what the use case and this is what was implemented. Okay. So what is happening is the purchase order actually would be validated, a clear consensus would be achieved in the private chain first, between the accounts payable team as well as between the vendor nodes. Once the consensus is met, okay, the purchase order is accepted, mark is valid or invalid, whatever is the case be, okay. And once the purchase order is marked, so here the endorser nodes actually link in the private chain were the basically the endorser the vendor node plus the API key of that region, okay, was the endorser, okay, in the private chain, okay. And other parties were also were part of the private chain network, but they were not the endorsers, okay. So here actually the every accounts payable team had the smart contract of those regions deployed actually on them, okay, which were doing the validations of the PO which was raised, okay. Whether a PO is raised by a specific region, does it match actually the region specific needs, okay, and whether PO contains actually the minimum desired mandatory fields actually in the PO, okay, what it's supposed to carry, okay, and probably plus it mentions actually the cost for each of these line items actually what it has been raised for, okay, which is you have the vendor node F&P and the probably the AP nodes, okay, accounts payable teams. Those validate, they'll simulate that PO, okay, onto their network. They'll validate actually whether the PO, what was the raise, does it ready, are received. Once endorsement is received or the required number of endorsement is received, it will send it to the ordering service, which was actually SRBT, simple by the time for tolerance, okay. The algorithm which was there, okay. So order node actually would call the ordering service, which had actually SRBT, okay. SPBT. Which is simple Byzantine fault tolerance, SBPT, okay, SBFT, okay, simple Byzantine fault tolerance. So once that is done, consensus is achieved, okay, ordering service actually would ensure, it will broadcast this actually to all the participants onto the network. So basically what you see here is it delivers back to the all the participants actually onto the network. They'll do a gossip check, whether what you see, the read-write set, what you have received from the ordering service. So does it matches actually with the read-write set actually what they have in their world state. Once they do it, they'll validate and commit this transaction into the ledger, and the event would get fired as a response or acknowledgement actually to the proposed node. So Hyperledger Composer, okay. So the basic building blocks of the blockchain are, first you need to have a business network. We all understand, in the use case what we took, the business network was comprising of the suppliers, the vendor organization, then you have the accounts payable team. It consists of the assets, okay. It consists of the transactions. You have smart contracts and certainly the ledger, okay. So all that actually makes your business network, okay. So it says business network connects businesses. You have participants with identity, which is issued actually to all the participants on the network, assets which flow over a business network. Transactions describe asset exchange. So in case of invoice, you'll have actually or probably even though the invoice processing contracts underpin transactions. So smart contracts certainly helps in terms of state change of the transaction. Okay, so basically the smart contracts are nothing but replacing your manual contracts or the paper contracts which was earlier in place before the blockchain or before the blockchain technology coming into picture. Okay, ledger is nothing but a log of transactions, we all know. Okay. So blockchain is a shared replicated ledger, which helps in probably achieving the consensus, immutability, finality, and the provenance. Okay. So what is Hyperledger Composer? Okay. So Hyperledger Composer, if you really see it, okay, you have a fabric over here, Hyperledger Fabric. So fabric is basically which is written actually on the Golang. It's similar to something what we have seen the get node, okay, in the Ethereum, okay. So you have a get was written actually on the Golang again. Hyperledger Composer is an abstract which is helps in interacting with the business layer as well as with the Hyperledger Fabric. You can write the your code actually in the high level languages like JavaScript, Node.js, and probably Python or whichever the language is supported today, okay. you can write it, it will while compilation or runtime, it will it will get converted into the low level, which is the Golang, and it interacts with the business applications as well as with the Hyperledger fabric using the feedback loops, which is nothing but the REST APIs. So we are seeing actually blockchain provide a low-level interface for business applications. Smart contracts code run on a distributed processing system. Inputs go into an immutable ledger. Outputs to a data store. Data store is nothing but your world state. Okay. And applications are built on top of a low level of abstraction. Okay. Hyperledger Composer, a suite of high-level application abstractions for business networks. Emphasis on business-centric vocabulary for quick solution creation. Features, model, okay. So you can probably model your business network. A model typically would consist of your participants, your transactions, and the controls which needs to be given actually to all the participants actually on the network. If you have it, you know, probably just click on it and you know, go over it. Okay, you have the sample transition which you'll define over here. Basically nothing but the transition states you'll define over here, and the event states, like, you know, what kind of events actually you would like probably to get communicated actually after the, you know, probably transition is completed successfully. Okay, events can get fired. So this is actually how a model file would look like. Okay, so applications use APIs to interact with the business network. Okay. Integrate existing systems of records using feedback or loop REST or REST APIs. Okay. Open tools, APIs, and libraries to support these activities. So exploit Hyperledger Fabric blockchain technology fully open and part of Linux Foundation project. Okay. So benefits of Hyperledger Composer is increases the understanding. Okay, because bridges simply from business concepts to blockchain. Okay, so if you really ask me, like, now anybody who understands the business, okay, would be able to define the model file. Okay, because it's pretty easy. I mean, you know, you understand, okay, who are the participants, what will be your transition states, what will be your who will be your participants would be, what is the asset, okay, which will be transacted over the business network, and what kind of events or communication you want actually, you know, to be shared actually with the proposed network or probably over the network for every kind of transaction it's done or executed successfully over the network. Okay. So if you're able to do that, if you're able to model your business network, you're probably as good as probably, you know, I mean, probably what I typically do, like basically as a consultant, like, yeah, you need to probably model my business network. Okay. And probably like to an extent, probably solution architect, it goes probably first model the network, then it can probably define the underlying technology, how it will interact. Okay. Saves time, develop blockchain applications more quickly and cheaply, because since you're developing it actually on a, no? First place, you're developing in a high level language. Secondly, like, no, you're able to probably like, no, validate your code much earlier. Okay. Rather than, you know, doing it actually, you know, once you build actually and probably, you know, you do it actually, like, public. Okay. Reduces risk because you're tested, efficient design conforms to best practice. Okay, conforms to best practice. Increases flexibility, higher level abstraction makes it easier to iterate. So if I look at it this way, let's say assume this is your business network. Okay, this is an example of a car auction market. Okay, so this is your business network. Okay, who we see over here. Here is your Hyperledger fabric. You have a composer layer. So what we have Hyperledger fabric has, you have the peers which are defined or onboarded actually onto the business network. We have the chain code which is deployed. We have the consensus algorithm which is configured. World state is defined. Obviously the ledger is defined. Basically, you know, you have a key values. Basically your database is, you know, configured as well as, like, you know, your key, your world state is defined actually. Okay, onto the fabric. Okay, next is your composer. Okay, so in the composer, what we do is probably, you know, you have the business network. You define the transactions, okay. You define the participants. You register the participants. Basically, registration is nothing but the membership services. You issue an identity key for these participants, and you define the assets. That's typically what you do actually, you know, on the composer. Okay. And then probably you know, loop back actually using the REST APIs. Okay. And that's how actually, you know, you build your business network. Okay. So you basically connect actually, you know, all these owners, okay, onto UIs, actually onto your composer, which will certainly interact using composer. But then actually, you know, in the background, actually, you know, using REST APIs, they'll be interacting with the Hyperledger fabric. Even the code which is written actually on the composer would actually, you know, get compiled into Golang, okay, during the runtime. The scripts, which is nothing but written in, you know, JavaScripts, okay, basically you define your transactions or the functions actually which will be done actually, you know, on those transactions. Okay. Your access controls. Okay. So basically, you know, what kind of access control you want to give to your participants. Okay. In this case, we are saying actually everybody can read everything. We're saying actually allow all participants read access to all the resources. Okay. So you define the access control. Everybody can submit transactions. So allow all participants to submit transactions. It depends actually, you know, basically what kind of rules you want to give actually to each and every participant actually onto the network. In this case, we have been quite flexible and we are giving actually, you know, all the participants all the access. Okay, so this is how actually you define your rules actually like to all the the participants on the network. Okay, so basically metadata is nothing but actually, you know, is the set of data actually, you know, which will flow actually onto the network, which is defined, okay, and would be defined actually as part of your business network. Okay. Solution developer develops models the business network, implements the script files that define actually transaction behavior and packages into a business network archive. Okay, we call it BNA. Okay. Solution administrator provision the target environment and may manage deploy. Okay. So this is how a business network archive would look like. You'll have models, script files, ACLs, access control lists, and the metadata. Okay, we'll see actually more in detail. So what the model would look like? Model actually, as we said, actually a domain-specific language that defines assets, participants, and issues. That's what we saw over here. You have actually like, you know, a sample asset, sample participants, and the events as well as the transition are defined. So if you want, you can add probably events as well over here. Okay. Then you go to access controls. So what access control does actually, you know, separates out access control from business logic, making it simpler. Can build actually access control into the business logic if needed. Access control engine evaluates rules for all access to assets. We defined actually, you know, in this case, we defined all the participants, all the access for read, write, reading actually everything actually, you know, which has been triggered actually, like everybody can read everything. Plus, everybody can submit actually all transactions. So model files actually, you know, is a script language actually, you know, which is which we use actually, you know, we call them actually npms actually. I don't know, if you have heard of. Okay, this is nothing but this defines the relationship, okay, to the samples participant actually, which is a relationship to the owner, which could be, you know, and then probably this defines anything but your data types. Okay, like, you know, this is of string type, and so that's what is defined over here. Okay. So this is nothing but a clean script language. Okay. Different participants actually onto the network. Okay. So in this case, we are saying allow the auctioneer all full access, allow the member read access, allow the owner of a vehicle total access. Okay. So different accesses you may give actually, you know, for different participants actually onto the network. Okay. But actually each and every member actually onto the network has to be defined certain level of access. So like, so in our case, probably like, you know, auditors or not auditors, okay, you know, probably you have the suppliers, you had actually, you know, the vendor notes, and then you have the access accounts payable team. Okay, so vendor notes actually had actually all the access actually, you know, to read and write actually, you know, similarly accounts payable team, but actually like, you know, supplier notes actually only had the read access, okay, to the ledger, didn't had actually the, you know, any you know, access to deploy or instantiate actually any of the smart contracts. Okay, and they had only the read access actually to the transactions which were written actually onto the ledger. Okay, so that's how you set up your network actually, you know. Next is actually script file. So basically you write actually your transactions functions or the state of transition changes which will happen actually basically like on a certain conditions which they when they are met. Okay, So basically, your smart contracts are written actually on what conditions actually the transition state would change. Okay, this is typically defined actually in the JavaScript and designed for any reasonable JavaScript developer to pick up quickly, okay, or easily. Okay, so name and version of the business network. Okay, a markdown documentation of the solution works with tools like GitHub to turn into a HTML page easily read in actually raw MD or HTML format. Okay.